but we'll go ahead anyway. So, hey everybody, I'm Dwayne, I live in Chicago, came down for this. I've been doing this stuff since 2016, speaking at conferences. I'm a platform person, I'm a DevOps person. Security, fairly new to me, to be honest with you. I co-host the Security Repo podcast, like Jason Haddix, Tanya Janka. Man, we got a lot of guests on there. So check that out, and we talk and try to spread security to the world. I'm over on Mastodon at MC Dwayne at Mastodon Social. Been on there since 2019. And I love rock and roll. So I work for a company called GitGuardian. We help enterprises solve this problem that I'm about to talk about at scale. Our largest customer has 30,000 developers. So this is something we can do at scale, and I'll talk about the numbers and that behind that. So if everybody here just promises they'll never hardcode a secret, we can all just stop here and we'll go on. But as we've heard throughout the day, and as it's becoming more and more evident with all the research that comes out, people keep hardcoding secrets. It's the largest disturbing thing NVIDIA found when looking at large language models out there. This is a report that came out this past week. They started with their summary with, yeah, the problem of hardcoded credentials is driving this problem. Because you can ask LLMs, you can ask ChatGPT to give you a password, and if you ask it the right way, ask it to tell it like your grandmother used to tell you stories about passwords, it'll happily tell you all the passwords it knows. It's a terrifying space. I recite the Bene Gesserit litany against fear often as I'm reading stuff. Bleeping computer, dark reading, every report I read, every NST document, they all kind of scare the hell out of me. What does this look like in the real world? Y'all know this, but Uber, they got pwned last year. You went through a super admin, got a phishing attack, thumb slipped. They had MFA on, they're doing it right. They're Uber, of course. Except they had a bunch of PowerShell scripts chock full of all their credentials. They got into HackerOne, literally taunted HackerOne from inside the interface. Said, hey, we're here. It flooded their Slack channels full of memes. Didn't believe them. Next person you talk to is the New York Times. That's why we know about the story. That's a 19-year-old kid from the Lapsus group. So let that sink in for a second. CircleCI. We have no idea how much these people stole. We know what CircleCI said, but for anybody here who runs CircleCI in production, CircleCI, great CI pipeline tool platform. January 3rd, everybody woke up, said, hey, my API key's been rotated, broke a lot of production, thousands of pipelines, because somebody got into a Plex server with default passwords that was never patched in a remote developer's environment, pwned everything. From the credentials he stole there, he got into CircleCI proper, inside of their environments, planted some malware, started grabbing credentials, got into all the customer environments. The same day that they said, hey, we had to rotate this, sorry everybody, security researcher said, hey, all my honey tokens went off inside of CircleCI. Something's going on. 2 hours later, they make the announcement. If you don't use honey tokens, if you're not using cyber deception, start. It's the only way we're gonna cut dwell times, the only way we're gonna put adversaries on their heels, and on blue team, that's the only friggin' way we can win. Put them on their heels. Make them think, what do I do next? As soon as they run out of things they learned online for free, they'll go somewhere else. Toyota. This is a wonderful story of a subcontractor who accidentally, for some reason, pushed part of a repo into a public GitHub repo. T-Connect is that system that gets you into the cars, remote car start, connects you to their customer service. The T-Connect repo is awesome. Does a lot of really cool stuff. If you're into car hacking, go check it out. You can find part of it online still. Had a real data key on it. That server had 296,000 customers' data. The Toyota website in Japan puts out a statement, hey, we got this happened. You're probably going to get phishing emails that know exactly what model of car you drive. Be careful. Sorry. AstraZeneca. If anybody knows anybody that got the email for this, let me know. I would love to read it. It's not anywhere online I can find. AstraZeneca, giant biomedical firm. A lot of pharmaceutical stuff. Developer one pushes environment credentials out into public GitHub. It's a test environment. What could go wrong? Another developer developer pushes actual customer data, HIPAA-compliant customer data, biotech medical testing data into a test environment. It sits there for a year in that perfect storm situation. They've never released the numbers. They don't know how many people were affected, don't know the depth of it, don't know exactly what kind of data they got out of them other than customers were affected. Sorry. Because unlike airplane crashes where they come out and say, this is exactly what went wrong. Here's how we don't do that again. Companies say, hey, I'm sorry. We got breached. And every other company got breached. So all of these companies still exist. It costs them millions in every case. It costs their customers trust. And that's the real problem. In all those cases, it was a password laying around somewhere. That's how they got in. You can hack a DLL all you want. You can get in through every leak mechanism your hacker brain can think of. But when someone calls up MGM and says, hey, I'm the password inspector, service desk person, give me your credential, that's how MGM happened. It wasn't a backdoor. It wasn't some crazy exploit. It was literally, give me your password. We're in. Lay of the land, got it. We just saw that great talk about the lay of the land, living off the land. We're not making their job any harder. And I don't care, honestly, about hacktivists. I don't care, honestly, about a lot of the stuff that goes on out there. Like the kid from Lapsus, he's a 19-year-old from Lapsus. I won't even give him the pleasure of saying his hacker name out loud. But he said he did it for the fun, for the lulz, but he's part of Lapsus. They owned everything. How much of that data got exfiltrated and shared? They don't know. They have no idea. Alfred Uger, if you don't know this guy, go look him up. Brilliant man. He invented CyberCop Sting, the first commercial honeypot system. 1998, I believe. Forget the year off the top of my head. But he said this, and I think it's great, because these aren't kids out here for a digital joyride. Hacking literally changed at some point. They might know where the term hacking comes from. Hacking. Where?
Yeah. Basically getting things that they think they're not supposed to. By changing.
Yeah, that's what it became. Yeah, original hacking came from MIT campus. Engineering students in the 60s built a car on top of the dome overnight. They disassembled a car, took it to the top of the dome, reassembled it, and they had to get a crane to get it down. They took a fire hose, hooked up a fire hydrant to a drinking fountain. That still exists at MIT. They have it in a museum case. It was engineering students who thought we'd play these fun pranks. Somewhere along the line, that became, hey, we'll take over a system. Somewhere along the line, it's like, we'll steal all the money. Because they want your machine resources. Verizon DBIR report from this year said it very plainly. 85% of hacking or of incidents that they were incidents they were investigated or organized crime. It is people that want your machine resources, they want your data. Machine resources, so one, they can crypto mine until you figure it out. Two, they can sell that. It is really cheap to buy Azure instances on the dark web. Really cheap. And then what's your data? They're going to ransom it to you. They're going to sell it to the highest bidder. Anybody here been to a dark web ransomware site? They look really cool. They really do. And it's terrifying when you see one in real life. I'm not saying go on the dark web and look them up. You can find blog articles with enough screen pics to scare the crap out of you. Again, Bene Gesserit, Lindy Against Fear. It's a growing problem, not a shrinking problem. I use the word secret and credential interchangeably. They're the same word in my head at this point in my life. So that's what I mean by it. API keys, usernames, database credentials, the database strings, Slack URLs, Slack bot connection URLs, anything that gets you access to a thing or encrypts or decrypts data. That's what I mean by secret. This is what it looks like in the wild. You see this all over the place. We saw it in the last, a really good example in the last session, if you were in this room, of, admin has his password in there. It's not encrypted, it's just there. And from there, he laterally expands. Because that's the common MO. You laterally expand, escalate your privileges as far as you can, and keep going until you pwn everything. But if you find a script completely full of these, you already own everything. You don't have to do much more work. How these end up here? We honestly think it's an accident. By the most part, it's just people weren't thinking when they did it. You're not developers, but I'll ask anyways. Anybody just debugged anything? Like, ever, like, hey, I got to figure out why this thing doesn't work? Yeah, your thought process when you're debugging is, I got to make this thing work. Not, am I following the strictest security protocols my company laid down as I'm working? No, I got to make this thing work. And it's not the same file. You're not on line 9 of whatever package this is, this file is. When you get done, there are 17 files open. You've changed 14,000 lines of code, it feels like. And it's the end of the day, and you're tired. So what do? Save, git add dot, or git add all. Don't do that. Git commit, push, leave the building. Up until the push, you can still salvage it. But once you push, it goes somewhere. We look at every single push that happens on GitHub public. That's what GitGuardian does as a platform. That's part of what we do. We look at anything that gets a commit, anything that goes public, becomes public. I forget the exact string. But you can do this yourself, api.github.com/feed. It's there, it's free. It's also a fire hose, be warned. Be prepared for that much data. Last year, over 1 billion commits got added to it by 94 million developers. That's up 27% growth. That's pretty good. We found 10 million hard-coded credentials just laying out there. That's 67% growth from the previous year. These aren't cumulative. This is just added in the year 2022. We already know it's worse than this year. The numbers come out in April, but yeah, our preliminary research is kind of terrifying on it. This problem's getting worse, and it can't just be new people, because that's 67% increase. While the platform itself only grew by 27%, you can't blame students, you can't blame new people. HCL, it's a fun fact. We'll see what happens with OpenTofu, and that whole split, but that's a whole other aggressive talk. Anyway, how did we find these? If you want to see how we built validators, this isn't just grep, this is like, hey, are these valid or not? A lot of those are valid. We have a whole validation process. You can go look in our docs to figure that out. What we find? Well, because we're looking for about 400 specific types of detectors and then a boatload of generic ones, we have this long tail of data, and that's why other is the biggest category by far. Well, not by far, but by a good chunk. But the types of keys that are getting out there are data storage. You can't have an application without data. I mean, you technically can, but that's a phone game that doesn't connect to the internet. I play solitaire on my phone, and, you know, it doesn't connect to the internet. But that makes sense, data storage, because what's the easiest way to authenticate is just throw the API key in the code, or throw it in a config file that maybe it got gitignored, maybe. Fun fact about gitignore, it doesn't work if you just pick up the entire file and move it into an S3 bucket. And last year, they found about 1.5 million just on public S3 buckets, just hanging out with all the Git credentials like in the .git folder because people picked them up and moved them. Cloud providers, that makes sense as well. Messaging systems, yeah. What specifically are attackers after? Data storage, cloud providers, and anything that gets them to that, which is what the messaging system comes in. Little fun breakdown. I don't know how important it is. Fun fact about AWS, it's only 3% because they have done a damn good job in the last few years of figuring out how to stop this. They specifically scan the internet all the time themselves. They're constantly scanning for keys. They have a part. They were the first partnership I know with GitHub. GitHub has a free program. If you pay anything that has an API key, you can tell them what that looks like, and they will watch for it and do something about it. In the case of OpenAI, they will invalidate immediately. They'll just hit the invalidation endpoint. Slack the same way. They'll hit your Slack invalidation endpoint and just invalidate that URL, whatever string. AWS doesn't kill it. It puts you in quarantine and gives you a threatening message that you have to fix this right now. And then I think that's after 9 attempts, then it deletes it. Google, not so much. Not so much. A lot of Google API keys, though, fun fact, are because things like Firebase identifier APIs are API keys, and then they're public keys. They're fine. Like, they officially say don't share this publicly, but then the people that write them are also like, yeah, it doesn't go to anything. You're fine. I disagree. Never, ever hard code a key, because then you get in the habit of hard coding keys, because, like, is that important? We ask a bunch of IT decision makers from very, very large companies, hey, how do you feel about all of this? What's your opinion on what's going on with this, data we just gave you? 75% said, yeah, we had a leak. We had some kind of credential incident. 60% said, yeah, it infected our company somehow. 27% admitted they're only using manual code reviews to try to fix this problem. Here's a magnifying glass, intern, good luck. That's what that means. It doesn't work. 94% plan on doing something about it someday. Everybody know that Creedence Clearwater song about someday never comes? Yeah, someday they'll fix it. The next 12 to 18 months. Sure they will. It's sea level too. It's sea level, not over WhatsApp. WhatsApp's at least secure. There's like, hey, what's the system password, Larry? Let me throw it in Slack real quick. Oh, we'll delete it. You deleted it from what's shown in Slack. Slack has internal logs that you're not sanitizing. I guarantee your company's not sanitizing it. I was kind of gloss over that one, but yeah. How many people have ever gotten sent a password over Slack or a similar system? I'm surprised it's that few hands. Because that used to piss me off so bad in a previous company. It's like, you can't do that. You literally cannot do that. Put it in one pass and then tell me what folder it's in. I can do that. Which is about my current company does, and I'm very happy about that. That just happened yesterday. It's like, what's the password? And like, oh, just it's in this folder. Like, got it. All right, so what can you do to stop all this? Well, that's what the rest of this talk is. That's what this whole point of this was. If you ask Google, this is my favorite Google developer doc that exists. And that's the whole thing. I know it's hard to read from the back, so that's why I made it bigger down the bottom. But it's basically redesign your app. Good luck. They didn't even say good luck. They just aren't remember saying good luck. And this was from last year, so they might have updated this and made it a little bit longer and said good luck now, but I haven't looked in the last few months. In reality, it's using systems like vaults. Vaults are awesome for multiple reasons. One, you can store adding encryption, you store encrypted. At rest, it's encrypted. That's awesome. It's also programmatically callable. So if you're using HTTPS, it's encrypted in flight as well. And then you only have to deal with the problem of scrubbing your logs, which you should be anyway, from any plain text references to anything that got pulled in from memory. The other awesome thing about vaults is they are super scalable. HashCorp makes a ton of money on Enterprise Vault, and they should. All the service providers, all the platforms, AWS, I got Azure Key Vault up here. They all have one, and they're free. Just use them. There's no reason right now in 2023 anybody should plain text a password anywhere except to put it into one of these things. Other reason these things are awesome is they're accountable. You can export an audit log. Where did the key come from? Who used it? When did it get used? You get invalidated. Who's touched this thing? And you have that insight. The downside to these is that, oh, good.
So you say that they are programmatically retrievable.
Yep.
It may be different throughout the different providers, but is there like a single marker for that particular key that you can call,
yep,
and then you can rotate the key inside that, then it's still going to be calling the same thing, so you don't have to change it?
100%. There is a caveat to that when you get onto like the AWS side, and then you're going to use like Cloud Service Manager. There's basically a middleware layer that takes care of the invalidation and cache rotation and all of that on those services. But if you're using like Vault, it's like straightforward documentation. But yeah, then in the code, instead of being a hard-coded password, it is vault.projectname.filename.credential or something. I forget the exact layout, but that's, I'm generalizing it up. But you're going to call it programmatically that way with a call to whatever service it goes to and a reference to the project it's in. But yeah, that's one of the other great benefits. Downside is these, in most organizations, are set up by the developer per project. And then that advantage of, hey, this is accountable, goes away. It is not just how many passwords do we manage as a company, how many vaults do we manage as a company. There's a good path to that. Is everybody's on the same exact version of HashCorp Vault Enterprise, you can just do a big old export, a big old import, and hey, you're all on the same page. That does take coordination. If you're a small company, you probably only have one or need to worry about one. If you have 30,000 developers, you're going to need to worry about this. Say that again?
So they're losing the ability to be able to check on every key?
Yeah, because you have to check every single vault at that point. That's the problem, is now you've distributed the... It's like using EMV files, which in and of themselves aren't a bad idea. EMV files are awesome if you use them right. I like AWS's version where you're storing in your home folder. Throw the extra layer of something like SOPS on top. SOPS is a free... encryption tool from Mozilla Foundation, SOPS, and it is a way to encrypt plain text in place. So you can pass around a plain text file that is completely encrypted, but anybody else that has SOPs like in their IDE with this correct encryption algorithm enabled will be able to see it. No one else will. So you can, and there's like a laundry list of ways you can encrypt it. So if you're an attacker who gets a hold of this and it's like garbage, which we saw last time, it's like, yeah, okay, here's the password. It's encrypted. I think I know what's encrypted as, but I'm not even going to bother with it because there's another way in. So how do we fix this for real? It's this. Tools are part of the solution. They 100% are. I work for a company that sells stuff. Tools are part of this. You can't do this without them. But if you don't have the processes around those tools, don't buy them. If you don't have people that, a way to train your people and disseminate that knowledge, if it's just like, here's a tool, good luck, close the door, and hope it goes right, it's like throwing a grenade in. It's like, it's going to cause chaos, and you're not going to get the reaction you want. Actually, a grenade's a bad scenario. It's like throwing a box of cake ingredients in a room and closing the door, and hoping when you reopen the door, there's a cake. It might happen, but seriously doubt it. No, it's... This is applicable to most things in life, not just this problem, but most problems in tech. So how do we go about creating these processes and tools and training people to use them correctly? I personally feel it comes from shifting left really, really, really hard. I stole this from somewhere. I have it in the speaking your slides. But who here is familiar with the term shift left? Who here likes the term shift left? Yeah, that's about the reaction I normally get. Because it got abused. It's like DevOps. It's meaningless. It just got a bunch of marketing thrown at it, and we end up hating it. Well, DevOps people end up hating it. DevOps days, Chicago, it's on my phone. And that's a common conversation you have in the DevOps community. It's like, is DevOps still a valid word? We like this? Shift left got a bad rap. I think we didn't shift left far enough. We got shifted left far enough that it's like, hey, I'm a security person, now developer, this is your job. And that's how it got interpreted. Like, hey, we test later, that's test earlier, but we're not gonna help you with that. We're just gonna piss everybody off. And we're gonna shift the thing left a little bit. I think this is where we have to shift to. This is a little bit of personal rant, but if you don't use a whiteboard, if you're not diagramming things and doing thread analysis and a discussion, from day one, you're already not shifting left. You're already waiting too long. How many people have ever, well, you're not developers, but how many people on the security side have ever been called in to a early design meeting, like, this is what we want to build? Yeah, you? That's awesome. That's the first time anyone's ever raised their hand to that question. No, second time anyone's ever raised their hand to that question, out of like 6 times I've given this talk. Yeah, it's very rare, that happen, though. But also an audit was kind of driving that, it sounds like, as well. Like, you're going to do this. Because if you draw, like, I got this like, great idea, and someone comes in and says, where's the data come from? You can't use that data. How are you going to pass these compliance checks? It's like, oh, we didn't think about that. It's like, well, how are you even going to test this part here? Like, how, what's with the testing plan? And it feels like, at the start, like, oh, man, you're shooting me down, and nobody likes that feeling. We got to get over that. Like, we're one team. Security isn't a separate team that is fighting dev. And unfortunately, that's how most people see it. What we saw... yeah, sure. Yes. Yes, 110%. I'm going to get to that, so thank you very much for queuing me up, teeing me up, because I'm going to drive that point down your throats for the next 10 minutes. So we at GitGuardian, we work with a lot of developers. We send millions of emails a year to people that... So if we, when we're looking at public GitHub, you might have heard our name or seen us, because if you push a credential onto GitHub public, we will send you an email. We automatically send the committer of that commit an email to that email address. So always use an email that works if you're committing things on GitHub, because there's people are trying to do the right thing and help you out there. But we work with thousands of developers, hundreds of companies, at all sizes and shapes. That's just our paying customers. And we said, hey, what are the trends we see at people that are really good at this secrets management stuff altogether, and people that aren't so advanced yet? Like, what are those levels look like? And somebody read Accelerate, that great book from Jess Humble, Nicole Ferguson, and Gene Kim. If you haven't read Accelerate, it's one of the most important books in the last 10 years. It's kind of out of date, but Dora Project keeps updating it. But anyway, Dora says there are four main leading metrics, and if you can identify those in your DevOps organization, you can tell how good you're doing. And kind of rate people and like how fast you get code to production, mean time to recovery in a fail event, average time, the mean number of times things break when you push. I forget the other one. But there's four. That's a different talk altogether. We said, hey, well, there's five levels we've identified. I think these map to how organizations work, back to your point. Because if you're working completely in silos, and this person over there, like, selling stuff and saying, hey, well, this is what we're going to deliver to you, Mr. Customer. And then you have somebody on the exec team telling the press, like, next 2 quarters, we got this innovation in AI. It's going to knock your socks off. And the developers are over there like, I'm just trying to figure out Kubernetes. Man, I don't know. Then, you're going to be working in these silos that don't talk to each other. And what that looks like from a secret management perspective is, you know, across these levels, it's, you're sharing text in plain, or sharing credentials in plain text because it just works and it's easy. And I can move on with my day. And I don't have to worry about the rest of it. Maybe I got a local config file. Maybe. It's probably checked in. Secrets just end up in our shared source control. They're just all over the place in a number of different ways. We're not thinking about scoping at all. It's not even on this list. But you're using third-party tools, libraries that have tokens in them. They have, like, PyPy Project. We're putting that numbers out very soon. But it's like a disturbing number of accounts in the last 6 years have just put valid credentials into their PyPy Project that then got distributed to millions of developers. It's probably sitting somewhere in your code base inside your company right now. That is a way in. Not a good one, but it's still a way in. The initial foothold is all that matters. Well, not the only thing that matters, but you know what I mean. And you're embedding things in scripts because you're not thinking about it. And no one's ever thought to look at your server logs, like in general, because you're all working independently. And security's over there trying to like make sure that your NIST compliance standards and your OWASP top 10 are getting dealt with. Meanwhile, developer on this end is just dumping everything into plain text. Level 2, we're starting to realize that this is happening. and maybe we need to work together a little more cohesively. Maybe we need to start having these conversations about what this looks like at scale. But we're still doing pretty much the same things. Secrets are unencrypted in config files, but we're not hard-coding them in line anymore. They're no longer in the code itself. We've stepped up from that. We're more mature than that. We're still using config files all over the place. IAC secrets are stored externally by the cloud service provider, which is good. But now on the developer side, the detection side, I should say, now you actually are starting to pay attention. Like, hey, maybe we should check it at our PRs. When we do close those PRs, those pull requests, maybe we should do a manual check from time to time. That's that 26%. They're kind of here, level one. Your final artifacts, you're pretty sure don't contain any secrets, but you're scanning for that every now and again when you think to do it with manual tools. Like, hey, we got to get this to production fast. You might skip over the tests. You might. This is some generalizations. This is a lot of generalizations. But the biggest one we have seen, like, that, in my opinion, separates, like, we haven't really thought about this, too. We're starting to think about this a lot more, is this last one. How often you rotate your secrets. If you only rotate a secret because you think it got compromised, that's not enough. That is not the right way to think about it. It's like, you're just setting yourself up for disappointment again in the future. And at this level, you are starting to read your logs and realize, like, hey, there's plain text in here. We should probably deal with that. I will say quickly, none of this is meant as a judgment. None of this is meant as, like, hey, you're here, shame on you. Because every project in the world starts here. When you open up an IDE and just start typing PHP, open bracket, question mark, PHP. I used to do a lot of PHP. You're here, because you haven't done this stuff yet. But now you're starting, like, all right, we need to cohesively work together a little better. Let's get the same people in the same room at least sometimes, and let's start building this thing at scale, a little more sustainably. Now Vault's into the picture. Like, now your dev teams are starting to, like, yeah, we use HashCorp Vault. Yeah, we use Doppler. Yeah, we use a keyless. Those are all different ways to do the same thing. Developers are starting to scope things for the first time. Because when you scope a credential, it should only do the specific little thing that it should do and no more. So if one gets their hands on it, it's like, okay, this gives me read access to an S3 bucket. Maybe that S3 bucket has something good in it. Maybe it's got cat pictures. Who knows? But you're starting to scope these things down so it's not just, hey, they have an S3 key. That's a root credential. You can go to everything. On the scanning side, now, before the code leaves the local developer machine, they're starting to run, like, open source tools you've built. Grep, Git grep is a great tool. If you don't know, a little sidetrack, most of the tools you love about Bash got included in Git. So if you've never tried just, like, Git LS or Git Bash, or not Git Bash, Git diff is just diff. LS is that, but grep is the one that I like. Grep solves the problem of where am I pointing grep, because it just looks at the index. I know this because Linus used it a lot. And he wrote a blog. Anyway, that's a whole sidetrack. But yeah, the developers now are starting to use tools like, hey, I'm going to look for the secret before I push this important thing. I squashed it, therefore it's clean, right? That's a whole other diatribe. Now we're starting to use tools like GitHub Actions to, hey, every PR, that's actually run a tool to check this. There's a bunch out in the market. This is a good place to be, honestly. If you're a small company and you're not pushing out anything that critical, or you don't think that's critical, this is a good place. You should, like, hey, I feel like I'm a level two. You should feel great. Like, you're doing a lot of stuff in the right way. The big indicator, though, is still that secrets have not been rotated on the regular. Once you start doing that, now you've put together a comprehensive security plan across the company. You really have at this point. Now, your business goals, your security team, and your developers should be working in concert on that whiteboard saying, hey, how are we going to do this? How are we going to do this at scale? And now secrets are being rotated on a regular basis, periodically. You have an idea about it. Like, yeah, we are going to rotate this at least every 30 days. Good place to start. Daily is even better, but let's not go nuts yet. You might think, that sounds like a lot of rotation. You can do this automatically on most platforms. AWS, there's a whole single-page document. It's like, how to turn this feature on. You do need to write a little script for it, but they provide the script. So you can just like, hey, AWS, I'm using your secret manager. Every 24 hours, I want a new secret in there. Go. Never think about it again. You're using vaults. You're rotating things, well-defined. No longer embedded in the current source code revisions. It's good. But now you're leveraging those local dev tools. I love Git because Git has an entire automation platform built into the heart of it called hooks. If you're not using Git hooks in your development process, look and see what you can do with it. It's amazing. There's a great website called githooks.com. Matthew Hudson built it a few years ago. It's a lot of data at the moment with at least new references, but the content, the explanations are rock solid. And there's a bunch of links out to things that people have built with Git hooks. Full disclosure, Git Guardian builds a command line tool, GG Shield, which you can run as a pre-commit hook or a pre-push hook to catch credentials before they get committed. If you stop it there, it's super easy to fix. The other thing I like about whiteboards is that whiteboard ink is stupid cheap, and the farther left you can go from your IDE, the cheaper it is still. But fixing it at the IDE level, that's still really, really cheap, and causes no real problems. Now you're constantly scanning everything. It's just scanning's all set up. Your security team does that. Developers are called in and are part of the security discussions when needed. Not every time, but when it's serious enough. And that's the big differentiator between this level and being the A team. Being one cohesive company. Yes, you have teams that logically you fit into. Yes, there are different departments. I'm not trying to say we should have completely flat organizations. But when your executive team, the sales team, security, and your crazy developer in the back who can fly the plane all have the exact same plan and know exactly what this looks like internally when you do a thing, this is a kind of our pie in the sky. Yes, we know companies that are this, that have learned the lessons the hard way and fought to say, all right, we have one vault system united across all of our orgs. We can audit the thing in literally 30 seconds. We know there are no hard-coded secrets. We can prove that. In case the NIST standards and CISA recommendations come to fruition in the next couple of years, and you're going to have to start attesting that you solved this problem because this is this big of a problem. You think S-bombs are bad? Oh, no, this is causing more heartache than anything else in the industry right now. NIST standards from last year, 2011-06, I think. I'm bad with numbers. Kind of point to, like, you should be able to prove you can deal with this if you're building microservices. If you're doing DevOps, you should have a plan about this stuff. There's a whole giant section about it. But so far it's not a regulation, like, there hasn't been an executive order saying you have to have attestation that you've tried to solve this. But these people could if they needed to. They could prove it. Because they have gotten rid of secrets wherever they possibly could. This one is the biggest one we see as a differentiator. Anywhere you can possibly replace a credential with role-based access control, or rule-based access control, depending on what you're using or what you're building, the better off you are. The best passwords are the ones that do not exist. Total sidetrack, but I only bank on my phone anymore because it's biometric. I don't have a password. I do not know the password of my bank account. I could reset it if I needed to. I own the reset path, but that's behind biometrics as well. I'm not worried about anybody stealing my password. I don't know how, I think it's 50 characters. I don't know. I just like randomly typed. But that's the biggest one. It's like, if you're serious about this, solving this as an organization, you're going to root out every password you can. It's like, this shouldn't exist. This should be a control. They still have to exist somewhere. You're still going to have to have a root password somewhere. It's unfortunately long-lived, but you can rotate those. There's even an argument to be made that if you completely have secured the recovery path for that root password, you shouldn't know your root password either, because you can just reset it every time. And then the multi-factor authentication of that is actually more secure than a multi-factor authentication on a long-lived password. That's a philosophical argument. Back to this. You're doing scanning literally on everything. Your remediation workflows are also automated. So, hey, someone pushed a secret and it shouldn't be there. Someone should get an alert that that happened, but they should also say, all right, and then this process would have happened, and then let me go look, yep, it's all taken care of now, and go back to the rest of their life. That is entirely possible. With a good platform and the right API calls, you can make anything happen on the internet. And then you write a little fix-it script that just automatically fires off. The goal with this talk is to, one, scare the crap out of everybody to stop hard-coding your secrets. Hopefully I've done that. Thank you. But the bigger thing is, like, we're making it too easy on people that are actively trying to hurt us. Almost every story you hear out in the news is something like, hey, they had this crazy zero-day breach, and then they found a giant pile of passwords. Or somebody called up and said, hey, I'm the count. That's one of my favorite Saturday morning breakfast cereal comics. Had one. It's like how hackers think they work, how Hollywood thinks hackers work is like, we're going to backdoor into their zero day, yada yada, a bunch of times. Like how hackers actually work. And it's like, I'm the county password inspector, and I'm here and calling to inspect your password. We got to stop making it easy on them. Pie in the sky, if you try to get there tomorrow, it's just going to suck, and everyone's going to hate you for being the security person who came back from a conference and said, you're doing it wrong. What you can take is that all of this is available, the secret management maturity model on Git Guardian's website. It's free download. It's not even behind an email sign up. It's there. You can take this back to your team and say, hey, here's a map. We're here. We're doing these things, but we can do this better. Have we thought about doing this? And when you have that conversation, we're in the room together, having that conversation of like, hey, how do we make the security improve? If you're only doing it in retros and you're only doing it because of an emergency, reactive to something that you've lived through, yeah, that gets the ball moving. Yeah, that gets business actually to care about this stuff. But that's also too late. How do you have this conversation with the team? I am completely open to suggestions on that, because I've still never heard a universal truth. But it starts with the conversation just with the person next to you and your team leads. If you're a security person who's never talked to your lead developers, there you go. Go Slack them and say, hey, you got 15 minutes next week. If you buy them donuts, they will talk to you for an hour. If you buy them Starbucks, they might give you 15 minutes. They're really busy, but so are you. It's the other way around, too. If you've never said, hey, you're an exec who's in charge of this department, I've never had a conversation about security around here. Why not? There's local organizations that love beer, that are in the area, that... Are they on that sign? I said it sounds good. 2600. They're out in the hallway. Go talk to them. Because if you never invited an exec or a developer or anybody else that you have to interact with to a local security function, why not? Why haven't you extended the olive branch? Say, hey, come on over, have a beer with us. Hang out, they might have a terrible time, but at least get the conversation started. But I'm Dwayne, I live in Chicago, going there in a few hours. Been a developer advocate since 2016 doing this stuff, mostly in platform stuff. Go check out the Security Repo podcast, we've got a lot of really awesome guests and a lot of great stuff planned. Talking about rock and roll, I love rock and roll. Hit me up on the internet. With that, I'll open it for questions. Not yet.
I think
That's CMMC. I was about to bring that up. Yep. Yeah. Thank you for bringing that up. Yeah, but that is specifically if you sell DoD contracts, if you're bidding on DoD contracts, and that was never enforceable until like this year, and they're still fighting back on it, saying, "Hey, you can't really audit us for that." Before 2019, did anybody know what an S-bomb was? Yeah. Sonotype knew what it was, and they've been trying to sell them for 10 years. Nobody else did. I talked to Sonotype enough about that. They're like, yeah, they're actually really glad about that order, but also it caused so much havoc and chaos. Anyway. Yeah. Good. I did not know that. I haven't done my following PCI advancement, so. Valid and non-expired. Non-expired is an interesting one. Valid, most things have a way to test for validity that's not intrusive. I say most. Not everything does. The random passwords don't. Anyway, but yeah, that's a good point. I did not know that, though. So, PCI 4. All right, any other questions? All right, enjoy the rest of the day.